Discover how intentional design and healthcare technology can revolutionize your practice. Join us as Dr. Craig Joseph reveals the secrets to making EHRs work for you, not against you, on this episode of Thriving Practice. Imagine growing your healthcare practice while actually improving your quality of life. Sounds too good to be true? Not with Thriving Practice Community. We're not just a networking group. Thriving Practice Community is a powerhouse collective of healthcare provider owners just like you, committed to scaling their practices without sacrificing their well-being. Our community of practice offers a meticulously crafted blueprint for practice growth that protects your most valuable assets, your time and energy. What sets us apart? We have created a unique ecosystem that blends cutting-edge business consulting, executive leadership development, expert-led master classes, and peer-to-peer roundtable discussions, all within a private, carefully curated community of like-minded professionals. Our mission is to help you transform into an agile entrepreneurial CEO who excels in both business acumen and patient care. No more choosing between practice success and personal well-being. Here, you can have both. And why not both? Now let's dive into today's episode. This embodies the very essence of what our community stands for. Together, we'll explore strategies and tips to guide you to better decision-making, lower stress levels, and increased bottom line. Whether you're a solo practitioner or leading a multi-provider practice, the strategies we're about to discuss could be just what you need to hear today for your business and your personal life. So get yourself a refreshment, grab your notebook, and get ready to learn how you can grow or scale your practice without sacrificing your time and energy. Let's dive in. Welcome back to Thriving Practice, the podcast dedicated to helping healthcare providers build successful and fulfilling practices. I'm your host, Tracy, and I am thrilled to bring you today's episode. We have a fantastic guest joining us, Dr. Craig Joseph, a pediatrician and chief medical officer for Nordic Global. Dr. Joseph brings a wealth of experience in healthcare technology and management consulting, working with medium to large healthcare institutions worldwide. In this episode, we dive into a topic that's crucial for every healthcare provider: intentional design in healthcare technology. Dr. Joseph shares invaluable insights from his book, Designing for Health, which he co-authored with his colleague, Jerome Pagani. It focuses on leveraging human-centered design principles to improve healthcare delivery. One of the key takeaways of our conversation is the importance of intentionality in designing healthcare systems and processes. Dr. Joseph emphasizes that it's not just about implementing technology for the sake of it, but about thoughtfully considering how that technology can best serve both providers and patients. We explored fascinating examples of how good design can streamline workflows, reduce physician burnout, and ultimately improve patient care. From discussing the evolution of medical note-taking to examining the intricacies of electronic health records, Dr. Joseph offers practical advice on how to make technology work for you rather than against you. What I loved about this conversation is how Dr. Joseph breaks down complex concepts into actionable insights. We all like to take action, right? So whether you're a seasoned practitioner or you're just starting out, you'll hear valuable tips on how to approach technology implementation in your practice with intention and purpose. So get ready and grab something to write with, because you're about to listen to an enlightening discussion that will change the way you think about healthcare technology and design. Let's dive in with Dr. Craig Joseph. Dr. Craig Joseph, thank you for coming on the show.
It is my pleasure to be here. I'm very excited.
My cheeks hurt a little bit. We were laughing a lot in the green room. So just prepare yourselves, listeners. His humor is great.
Now I'm purposely going to say nothing funny.
Right? Okay, here we go. Somebody will laugh.
Yeah, that's probably true.
Well, I'm so happy to have you on the show. I'm really looking forward to our conversation. So before we dive in, we'd like to share with our listeners where you're located physically in the world.
I am at my home in Las Vegas, Nevada, of all places. Of all places. Yeah. Yeah.
It's, I have a lot of family in Vegas, actually.
That's awesome. Most people didn't know that you could live here. and to be honest, I did not know that you could live here until 4 or 5 years ago. And yeah, there's a place far away from, there's a place that's Las Vegas that's not on the Strip. And most people don't realize that or think about it, but it's beautiful here. We've got mountains and we've got snow and we've got incredible heat and all the stuff you want.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great, it's, I don't love like Vegas, Vegas, Strip Vegas, but I love Nevada. It's so pretty. Yeah. It's beautiful. Yeah,
absolutely.
Amazing. So tell us about Nordic Global and kind of what you're up to, and then we'll go from there.
Sure. So I'm a pediatrician. I'm the chief medical officer for Nordic Global. We're a consult, a healthcare management consulting company. And so we work with generally medium-sized to larger institutions. So think about academic medical centers or large health centers, large hospitals all over the world, and help them chiefly with technology and how they leverage technology for taking care of patients, for keeping the lights on. So revenue cycle is very important. No margin, no mission. And we've expanded since we kind of started just focusing mostly on technology. So now we help with operations, how you run a hospital, and a lot of different aspects to really anything that you need to kind of keep the lights on. We have experts in. And so I focus principally with working with physicians and in medical groups and often on technology. I have a technology background. I used to work for a big electronic health record vendor. So got a lot of experience in that area.
Very cool. In the green room, we were talking about how just the importance of design. And I would love to hear kind of your intro to that and then dive a little more into that, because I think this is really an important aspect of all pieces of running a successful practice, especially including the patient experience.
Yeah, well, you know, thank you for queuing that up. I recently co-wrote a book just late last year called Designing for Health, and really focuses on how you can leverage human-centered design principles to make healthcare better. And that's, again, from the small single person office or clinic to a large healthcare system like Kaiser Permanente or one of the other really big systems somewhere in the world. And we all can be leveraging some of these basic, obvious things of how people think. When I talk about design in this context, I'm not talking about what color goes with another color. I'm really, really bad at that. And that's why we have interior decorators and designers who know about that. I'm talking about more of, hey, what is the, how is the technology configured to make things easy? So people can do what you think is the right thing to do, right? How do, oftentimes I see offices, I see doctors, I see administrators make things that they want to happen almost impossible to happen, right? Mm. So like, oh, well, just go to the patient portal and send us your information. That would be great, because then we don't have to ask you for it when you get into the office. Okay, well, but it's often hard for me to do that. It's not obvious. So it's not how I think it should be. And so there's no user manuals. We don't have user manuals anymore for how to do some of these things. And so it just gotta work. And there are ways that humans think. Most of us do. You know, we if we see a mouse, we all now know what to do with that mouse, and we know how that mouse interacts. And expecting it to work in a different way for your practice or your application or your workflow, it's not gonna. It's your chances of being successful are limited. So kind of just understanding some of those basic principles and then intentionally applying them to what you do really makes all the difference in the world, or at least it can.
I think the phrasing that you used, you know, paraphrasing, intentional application, that word intentional, as I mentioned, we had an architect on the show, and she was talking about intentionality and how important that is. And so I'm curious if you can elaborate on that a little bit, like from in a way that non-lay people would understand.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm probably one of those people. When I think of intentionality, I just think of, hey, this is something that we're going to think about before we break ground, right? So we're going to think about what is the goal of this? We can talk about technology. We can talk about, you know, building a new office. You know, what are the chief goals of this one project or this one technology? We're building, everyone knows about patient portals connecting you to the electronic health record. You know, we're building a way for patients to send us information. Because oftentimes when they walk in, we ask them to fill out all these forms and they can't remember. And sometimes, you know, they could have told, if we would have asked them ahead, they could have called someone to get some of that information or asked someone mm-hmm. so they could be as up to date as possible, as specific as possible. And so I would say non-intentionality when kind of designing that would be, well, here's what we should do. We should have them we'll have them download the paperwork and then they can scan it. And then they can upload it and then we'll get all the paperwork and it'll be great. And I think that's probably suboptimal, right? Like that yeah. is your goal really to get a copy of the form, the paper form you use now? Well, no, actually the goal is to get that information that's on that form. That's why we created a form when we had paper and we had nothing else, no other choice. Right. Now wouldn't it be better to kind of collect that information discreetly, and then we can populate it into our electronic health record or any other technologies that we use, and we can do all kinds of cool things with it, as opposed to having a picture of it that then someone has to just re-enter, or even worse, it just sits there and it's of no use to anyone. And so, you know, intentionally thinking about what are we trying to do? Oh, we're trying to transfer information from the patient to our practice. Okay. How can we do that? And let's consider all of the new and available ways of doing that, not just, you know, going with what we're used to for the last 20 years. That may not, sometimes that's right, but mm-hmm. oftentimes that's not.
Yeah. I think of that just when you're saying like, download it, print it, fill it out, scan it, send it back. My brain froze actually. Yeah.
And, but this is the real world, right? Like this is what happens. And again, that's what I mean by intentionality. Like just kind of thinking through, the goal is not to get a copy of the form. That actually might seem like the goal at the beginning, because I've had so many times I've talked to people and said like, hey, what were you thinking here? Mm-hmm. Like, well, we needed to get the copy of the form. Like, did you though? Is that what you were really trying to do? Is the form, or was it the information on the form, or was it something else that you wanted to, you know, collect and analyze and do something with? And it seems silly afterwards when you kind of look back on it, but it's not silly at the time that it's happening. So you got to kind of think that way.
Yeah. I would imagine too, like when you think about all the things an EHR can do, right? You don't want just a form that's been scanned and put in there, because then you can't really look at your data.
Right.
Right.
Okay. You can't leverage it. Right. And the goal of using technology should never just be to use technology. Right? It mm-hmm. should be to achieve some outcome. And so if I ask you what your allergies are and you write it down and I put it on a piece of paper or I put it, you know, somewhere scanned in the electronic health record, it's a very little use. It's mm-hmm. much more helpful if it's discreetly in there, so that when I order something using the same computer, it says, whoa, hang on, time out, right? That's what we're looking for. So I don't have to think so much about that. Mm-hmm. As opposed to when I was practicing a while ago on this stuff called paper, that was a question I had to think every single time, like, okay, let me stop. Let me look at the allergy list. Now this antibiotic is going to be fine for you because you don't have any allergies that we know of, or let me, you know, reconsider that. And so what we want to do is leverage technology. So again, putting that somewhere in the computer and just having it there, but I have to go looking for it. I'm not really winning. I'm not feeling it.
And you're not saving time. I mean, this is one of the things that technology is meant to do for us, right? Is to really support in, I mean, not that we don't want our doctors thinking, but thinking about things that could be brought right, you know, flagged, boom, right? Like back in the day, there was a red sticker on the outside of a chart indicating reminder, you know, of whatever the reminder was, say an allergy.
Sure.
right? So similar, and I mean, that was a form of technology before we use computers for all of that, right? So if you have to still go digging, that doesn't seem very efficient. It doesn't seem like a good use of time.
Right. Yeah.
For anybody, but especially for providers who are already limited in their time.
You know, one of the things we want physicians actually thinking, but we want them thinking about things that only they can think mm-hmm. about. Right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, one of my rules, I've worked at hospitals and in technology. And one of the rules that I made up multiple rules, but the most important one was, hey, don't ask a doctor a question if you didn't need to go to medical school to answer that question, right?
Like that.
So mm-hmm. yeah, and it's pretty straightforward, but we do it all the time, especially with technology. Like, well, the doctor can enter the allergies. Well, you didn't need to go to medical school to ask a patient if they have any allergies and then to record them, right? And so let's let someone else do that. You know, is the patient pregnant? That's a good question to ask before we take an x-ray, but you didn't need to go to medical school to ask that. So let's let the physicians focus on the stuff that only they can do. That's where and we want to feed them on a silver platter, all the information that they need. We want to remind them when they need a reminder of something that's important. But we want to do it at the right time, which means the right place in the workflow. If you want to see an angry physician, and in my roles, I see many angry physicians. Often they're angry at me, whether it's correct or not. I'm the one taking it, and they say, "Hey, I love it when your electronic health record reminds me of something I was just about to do." Right? Like, that is the wrong time. Like but at the same time, like, hey, I just closed the chart. I'm kind of done with this patient. I'm moving on to the next patient. And then you're telling me to do something that actually was a pretty good idea, but I wish you would have told me 5 minutes ago when I was writing orders that.
Right.
So we're always looking for that sweet spot of giving you the right information. And it doesn't really, I'm talking about physicians, but we could talk about anyone, whether you're a nurse or the front desk staff or someone in the billing department, you know, giving you the right information that you need at the right time, in the right way, so that it's actionable. That's another pet peeve of mine from a design perspective. Hey, doctor, this patient is overdue for their mammogram. Hey, computer, thank you so much for telling me. What do I need to do? Oh, I have to go figure out how to order that mammogram. So now I have to click in a bunch of different places and get to the orders and remember that I'm ordering a mammogram. And was this diagnostic or, you know, what kind? Wouldn't it be nicer if when you gave me that reminder, computer, that you said, hey, patient's overdue for a mammogram, click this box right in front of you. It's already set up. It's all perfect, right? That's an actionable alert. That's a piece of clinical decision support that doctors actually want. What they don't want is to be reminded of things that they're about to do. They don't want to be reminded of things that don't make any sense. So, you know, telling me that a patient is allergic to a medication that I'm not actually prescribing now, which just happened, or telling me to, you know, you need to worry about levels of this medicine in this patient when it's actually eye drops and almost none of it gets absorbed. Like, these are things that make people crazy. Yeah. and we try to avoid those and, you know, kind of thinking through that design process again. Hey, we want to alert doctors about this thing. Okay. Well, maybe the first step is, when do we not want to alert them? Like, let's think about that. Let's do that intentionality exercise. Like, oh, well, if it's unlikely to be a problem, we don't want to alert them. Okay. And again, that eye drop was a great example of an alert that made a lot of sense for an IV medication, but really made no sense for the form that was being used. And some physicians gave some feedback that that should change. And it did.
Yeah. Well, this is, I think, it, in my mind, as an operations person, what I'm hearing is time and energy, right? Because this is, in our world, in my world, in my company, this is what it's all about. Like, supporting our providers and clearing those pieces off of their radar screen as much as possible. And the use of technology is a big piece of it. And, you know, I've heard, because we work with all kinds of providers and EHR when they're, at least when they're first implementing, usually after a while it gets better, and they're, if they have a good one and they have good support, they can tweak it. But that's what I hear a lot. It's like, oh my gosh, this thing, it's not intuitive. It's not, you know, it can be really frustrating for them when, especially I think if they did kind of old school, like if they were practicing back before EHR was really the thing, I think that's the real frustration, because while it might take more time to handwrite notes or whatever, it's straightforward, right?
So, a lot of things were different. And you mentioned notes. When we used to write notes, and again, that you're looking at me when you're describing that, you know, pre EHR practice. When I was practicing, it was in paper, fully in paper. And then I went to go work for an electronic health record to help, or vendor to help kind of transfer that kind of knowledge of how we practice into the technology. But with paper, our notes were very, they were short and they were succinct, because it took a lot of energy and hence time, and then hence money, to write these notes. And so we just kind of put the facts on and used a lot of abbreviations. So we knew what we were talking about, but maybe other people didn't know what we were talking about. And now if you look, we've created, the term is, note bloat. We have notes, we have progress notes that are 3, 4, or 5 pages, because the electronic health records often make it very easy to bring in outside information. And so before, I would say something like, you know, the CBC was normal, the complete blood count was normal. Well, now it's actually easier for me to say .CBC, something like that. And I can bring in the entire result, which is 14 different mini results often. And so it's all this extraneous information, when in fact, you know, you're not actually paying the doctor to list all of the labs. You're paying the doctor to order the right labs and then interpret them and then decide on the course of action based on those diagnostic tests. And so that's really the smart thing to focus on. And instead we have these tremendously large notes that, are 3 or 4 times as big and actually say a lot less than what they used to on paper. So those are the benefits. Those are the benefits that we've lost, actually. Yeah. We're trying to get them back now.
It can be a little confusing, I think, from the patient's perspective to go in and read notes when they're 4 or 5 pages long or whatever. Yeah. And some of it is detailing out all of the blood work, which there's just not enough windows to open to Google all of that.
To try to find that out. Well, it's also disconcerting when they read kind of these canned notes and they're like, this is a very complete physical exam. I don't remember the doctor checking my, you know, my reflexes.
Right. Yeah.
And so, and the reason is, I don't think most of the time, it's not that the doctor's trying to be fraudulent. It's just that they have a kind of a boilerplate, you know, physical exam that they put in there. And then if you don't edit it, then it looks bad for when the patient's looking at it and saying, well, we never talked about that and we didn't do that. And it's a little confusing. And, and as you've alluded to, patients are getting access to their notes. They've always had access to their notes. The notes, technically all the documentation about them belongs to them. But it's been in the past a challenge to get that, right? You had to go in, you had to sign some forms, you had to pay some money typically. Now with the patient portal, oftentimes those notes are just available the second you sign them, and people are reading them and commenting on them and bringing them back to you the next time. And I think it's great. It's transparent, and it often helps to make sure that the communication is happening. But it does add a little extra complexity to make sure that you're writing it in a way that is helpful to you and your colleagues, but also to the patients themselves.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, I think it's you know, we sometimes joke about our love-hate relationship with technology, but I don't see any reason why, with intentional design, as you said, technology can't be the friend of the provider. And from a business operations perspective, the amount of time and energy that's recovered in using that, right? Like you said, there's a boilerplate. Like if you just remember, maybe have a checklist of things to make sure that you take out or edit or add or whatever, then you're golden, right? There's Bob's your uncle or whatever. Interesting. But I mean, I think it's a tool. especially with that intentionality. And I would imagine, like, in different areas of practice, there's probably a lot of back and forth in the design and getting it right, so that when you bring in, say, a new EHR to a practice or to an organization, that they're getting it right, so it's actually useful instead of a frustration.
Yeah. Oftentimes, one of the key things to do is to remember that you're not trying to recreate, we alluded to this earlier, not trying to recreate your current processes necessarily, right? And that's where a lot of people, they go wrong. Mm-hmm. Because they're just trying to, like, well, this is how we do it, so let's configure the software to do it that way.
Yeah.
And that may not be the right way to do it.
Yeah. Often. I mean, in the corporate world, we hear this a lot, like, just because that's the way we've been doing it doesn't mean that's not actually a very good answer, unless we've been doing it this way and it works really well clinically, right? Okay. Maybe that, but from a business operations perspective, there's always room for improvement. And I don't know a single provider who I've ever met who would not like their practice to run more smoothly.
Yeah. And sometimes it takes you getting out of the way.
Mm-hmm. It does.
From the office, man, right? Like, mm-hmm. different people know how to do things and in more efficient ways, and kind of learning from peers and no reason to innovate when you can imitate. Right. Mm-hmm. And so if someone else is doing it and it's working, you should just try it and see. And oftentimes that's, I find often it's the physicians who are in the way of trying to make operations better. Mm-hmm. And they're shooting themselves in the foot, but they don't realize it.
Yeah. Listen carefully, listeners. It's a tough one. I mean, this is something that even when we were industry agnostic, I just want you all listeners to know you're not alone in this, that I have to be told to get out of the way in my company sometimes.
Well, I'm perfect. I don't expect that from you. Yeah. So I'm always right. Did I mention that doctors have a problem? And so I guess I'm exhibiting that right now. I mean, no one likes change.
It's hard.
And it's difficult. And I'm opposed to change for, if we're just changing something to change something, well, then let's not do that. But if we're changing something because we think it's going to be faster, more efficient, it might actually be a little slower now, but it's going to have a lot of benefit to us in the future. You know, selling something to someone is convincing them to do it. Oftentimes I find it's helpful to say, like, hey, would you be interested in being able to find all your patients who are on this particular medication or have this particular lab, right? Something that they're like, oh yeah, that might be something that I would want to have available to me in the future. Okay. Well, would you put in an extra 5 seconds of work, you know, three times a day? Yeah. Yeah. I would do that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, now it's not as onerous anymore because now they see the benefit.
Yeah. I think that's a big piece of it, is understanding the classic WFIM question, like, what's in it for me? What's going to happen if we implement this? And I agree with you. No change just for the sake of change, but from a business operations perspective, efficiency is key to all things. And so being able to even if you do need to slow it down a bit initially to learn it, to get better at it, to make the adjustments that you need for it to give you what you need to be able to run your practice, I still think it's worth it. Yeah.
Oh yeah. And again, from an operation standpoint, like, I would much rather automate some data collection things so that the humans that I'm employing are free to actually interact with these other humans that are paying us. Right. And so, I'd much rather you spend time on the phone dealing with billing issues than, which I wish we didn't have, but if we're going to continue to have billing issues, let's have a human have time to have those conversations, as opposed to transferring information from a piece of paper into the computer or doing something else that really should be automated at this point.
Yeah. Yeah. Agree. Well, this has been such a great conversation. And I feel like understanding, like, from the perspective of design is a great tool for our listeners. I don't say this out loud very often, but, you know, generally speaking, providers aren't business people. They just have a business. And so understanding, like, from the perspective of design is going to improve your business operation and your flow, and definitely will positively impact your bottom line. The more efficient you are, the tighter you can run the ship, right? So I just think that this conversation is super important. I really appreciate the work that you're doing and what you're providing for people.
Well, thanks. It's a lot of fun. And once you actually start thinking about these things from an intentionality perspective, you get irritated when you see workflows that are not well designed, right?
Yep.
And in the book, we talk about one of the innovators in this area who started off actually just looking at doors. This has nothing to do with healthcare, how doors function. And once you kind of read about how doors are supposed to function, then when you see a door that has handles on both sides, clearly one side you're going to push and one side you're going to pull, yet they have a handle on both sides, and handles are clearly meant for most humans to pull something, you'll be like, why is this designed this way? It could be better. And so you get frustrated when you're at the grocery store, or even if you're a physician, you're going to someone, when you're a patient and you're going to a different doctor's office, you're like, why am I having to do this? I don't make my patients do this. And you get irritated. So that's a good thing. It's a good thing to get irritated, because then you know that you found a better way and everyone's not doing it that way.
Yeah. And that's how we spark change, right? Is by noticing things and by entering into a different realm of intentionality. Yep. Yeah. Well, if our listeners want to learn more about the book and about design, where should they go?
Well, certainly the book is on Amazon. And so again, Designing for Health, and I co-wrote it with a colleague of mine. And so can search for it that way. Also, get some information about the company I work with. It's nordicglobal.com. And we post a lot of blog posts and white papers. And we actually have our own podcast as well, where we talk about design and healthcare with the same title, Designing for Health. And so those are all different areas that people can see what we're thinking and what we're doing and who we work with and how we work with them.
We will link all of that in the show notes to make it very easy for our listeners to go and find whatever sparks for them.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Do you have any parting wisdom or anything that we didn't discuss that you'd like to share with our listeners?
Everything that I have anything smart to say, I think I've just said in the last half hour or so. I just, again, focus on that word intentionality. If you got it right because it was an accident and you just like flipped a coin, that's nice, but not as impressive as if you thought it through as much as you could have and then did it. Sometimes that doesn't work. We all know we've tried to design a room or a house or an office, and you're like, we really thought it through, but then we didn't realize this was going to be a tight corner or that wheelchairs wouldn't go around here very smooth. You know, those kinds of things do happen. But boy, if you've thought it through, you're going to be right a big chunk of the time, and you've been intentionally working on that, your chances of being successful, or at least somewhat successful, are much higher.
Awesome. Craig, thank you so much for coming. Really, really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
What a great conversation today with Dr. Craig Joseph. We have explored the fascinating world of intentional design in healthcare technology, and I hope you are inspired to take a look at your practice's systems with fresh eyes. Dr. Joseph's insights on making technology work for us rather than against us are truly game-changing. From rethinking how to approach electronic health records to considering the patient experience in every aspect of your practice, we covered so much ground. Dr. Joseph's emphasis on intentionality, really thinking through processes and asking yourself, what are we trying to achieve before implementing any changes? It's such a simple yet powerful concept that can lead to significant improvements in efficiency and patient care. Remember, as Dr. Joseph pointed out, just because we've always done something a certain way doesn't mean it's the best way. There's always room for improvement, and sometimes that means stepping back and letting others innovate. So I hope this episode has sparked some ideas for you for how you can apply intentional design principles into your own practice, whether it's streamlining your EHR use, rethinking your patient communication methods, or simply being more mindful of your workflows. There are so many ways you can use these concepts to create your thriving practice. Big thanks again to Craig Joseph for sharing his expertise with us. And thank you, our wonderful listeners, for joining us for another episode of Thriving Practice. Until next time, keep striving for intentional excellence for your practice. As we wrap up today's episode, I want to take a moment to shine a spotlight on you, our incredible listeners. Your support and engagement are the heartbeat of this podcast, fueling our mission to empower independent healthcare practice owners like yourself. If today's episode resonated with you, there's a powerful way you can help us amplify our impact by leaving a review. Your honest feedback not only helps us fine-tune our content to serve you better, it also acts as a beacon guiding other practice owners to this valuable resource. Let me share some eye-opening statistics with you. Did you know that podcasts with over 100 reviews attract, on average, 3.7 times more listeners than those with fewer reviews? That's according to a recent Buzzsprout survey. Even more intriguing is that 70% of podcast listeners discover new shows through recommendations and online reviews. Think about that for a moment. Your review could be the lifeline that connects a struggling practice owner with the insights and support they desperately need. In just a few minutes, you can spark a transformation in someone else's professional journey. So, are you ready to be a catalyst for change in our healthcare community? Head over to Apple or Spotify podcasts and let your voice be heard. Share your thoughts, your takeaways, even your constructive feedback. Every word counts in building this thriving community. Before you go, remember that the conversation doesn't end here. Visit the link in our show notes to explore more resources, connect with like-minded peers, and even schedule a call with me. We're all in this together, supporting each other to create practices that not only survive, but truly thrive. Thank you again for being an integral part of the Thriving Practice podcast community. Until next time, keep pushing boundaries, keep growing, and above all, keep thriving.